Okay, I would like to take stock of what we have discussed so far and to discuss a very general principle, a very general methodology for scientific reasoning. And this is based on maximum entropy. So the idea is that given that we have a way to quantify the information content of a random variable, we have a way to be sure of we can specify in a precise manner a state of knowledge where we don't know anything. And this is given by those random variables for which the entropy is maximal. Okay? And actually, this is quite interesting because, as you know, Western scientific thought is probably started with Socrates, was saying that the only true wisdom is in knowing that we know nothing. So the fact that we can specify in a mathematically rigorous way states of knowledge where we don't know anything is sort of interesting. Okay, so let's start with the situation where we have a random variable that takes value in a given set, discrete set of number of finite elements. Okay, then we know that the state of knowledge corresponds sorry, state of knowledge corresponds to a probability distribution. And then if we want to specify the state of knowledge where we don't know anything, then this is given by the argmax over P of the entropy as a function of P. Let's say this, call it P star. And we know that this distribution is the uniform distribution, is one that assigns the same probability to every outcome. Okay? So very good. So and there are several ways in which you can figure out that this is the maximal corresponds to maximal uncertainty or to maximal ignorance. So, for example, if you think about how you should ask questions, binary questions, to figure out what is the value of key, then in this case, the best way is always to ask questions in such a way that the number of possible alternatives is divided in two at every question. And there is no smart way to ask this question. So every way in which you can group the number of alternatives in half gives you the same measure of the information content. Okay, so now imagine that we know that a certain function f of x of this random variable takes a value f. In particular, we know that the expected value of f of x takes value equal to F. Then we can incorporate this state of knowledge in our probability distribution by looking at what is the probability distribution that solves the problem where we maximize the entropy on all probability distributions subject to the constraint that the expected value of F is equal to F. Okay, so this problem can be cast in the problem where we maximize when we introduce Lagrange multiplier. So we maximize on P, on lambda, and on say nu, the entropy, which is minus sum over x, p of x, log p of x. Then we can add to this the constraint that the expected value of f of x must be equal to f. So sum over x, p of x, times f of x, minus f, must be equal to zero. And then we should also add the normalization constraint. Okay, sum over x of p of x must be equal to one. Okay, so now if we solve this problem, we can solve this problem by taking a first order derivative. So the first order condition of this is like many other problems that we have seen. And if you work it out, you find that the solution to this problem is a distribution which is e to the lambda times f of x divided by z of lambda, which is a normalization constant, which is called the partition function. And so this is a maximal entropy distribution that encodes the information that encodes this information here and only this information. Okay, so so this probability distribution, as you can see, is a probability distribution that depends on one parameter lambda. So let's call it p lambda of x. Okay, so you can easily see that this corresponds to an optimal, it's a unique solution. Because when you write h, the maximum where p of the entropy, such that when you write the solution of this problem as a function of lambda, then you get that this is minus the sum over x of p lambda of x log p lambda of x. So this is equal to minus lambda times the expected value over this distribution of f of x, plus log of z of lambda. Okay, when you substitute this probability distribution, you substitute here, you get this plus log z of lambda. Okay, now you can also see that the expected value, the expected value over lambda of f of x is equal to the derivative with respect to lambda of the log of z of lambda. Okay, because if you take a derivative, if you take the log of z and you take a derivative, then you will see that an f of x gets down to the, and this is essentially the same calculation that we did for cumulant generating function, because the log of z is a cumulant generating function of the variable f of x. Okay, so then when you write this here, you see that the first order condition, so that this function here is equal to minus lambda times the derivative with respect to lambda of log of z of lambda plus the log of z of lambda. So then if you take a further derivative of this function as a function of lambda, then what you find is minus the derivative with respect to lambda of log z minus lambda, the second derivative with respect to lambda squared of log of z, plus the derivative with respect to lambda of log of z. But now clearly these and these cancel. So the result of this is that the derivative with respect to lambda of this optimization problem as a function of lambda is equal to minus lambda times the second derivative that, for the same reason as before, is essentially the variance of the random variable f of x on the distribution p lambda. Okay, so what you see is that this is positive if lambda is negative, this is negative if lambda is positive. So you see that there is a unique solution to this problem. So if you write this sigma of lambda as a function of lambda, you will see that there is a unique maximum at lambda equal to zero, okay? Because it should be decreasing for lambda positive and increasing for lambda negative, okay? So so what we have seen is that so the solution of this problem must have this exponential form, and also the value of lambda is unique, okay? Because essentially then the value of lambda, because this is a convex function, then the value of lambda that solves this problem, for which I remind you, so the condition that fixes lambda will be the condition that the expected value of f of x over this distribution, which is the derivative with respect to lambda of log of z, this must be equal to f. Okay? So so this tells you that the value of lambda that you have to choose is the one such that this condition is satisfied. Okay, very good. So indeed, the nature of the solution of this problem, indeed, seen as a function of lambda, it's a little bit not very transparent, because the solution to this problem is actually a function of S, of F, okay? And the nature of this problem, as you can see, so we should write indeed that the solution of the problem of this problem here is a function of f, and so we will write it that as sf. Okay, now the mathematics that describes this problem is essentially, so you see we get an exponential distribution, so it's very similar to what we have found for large deviation. Indeed, the mathematics is exactly the same, and the reason is that this is the mathematics of Legendre transform. Indeed, you can write this problem as the minimum introducing a Lagrange multiplier lambda to specify this constraint, as you can write it in this form, plus lambda the expected value of f minus f, and now you can manipulate this expression as we did for large deviations. So this is the minimum over lambda of minus lambda times f minus another problem that I write as a minimum over p of minus h of p minus lambda expected value of f. Okay, so in this way you see that I have connected one optimization problem, which is this one, to another optimization problem, which is this one, and that I can call this new optimization problem psi of lambda. I can call this the solution of this optimization problem psi of lambda as the minimum over p of minus lambda expected value of f minus the entropy of p. And then this problem here, the original problem, S of f becomes just the minimum over lambda of minus lambda times f minus this psi of lambda. Okay? Very good. So, and so now if I use my solutions above, so you can check that your psi of lambda, so you see that S of f is the Legendre transform of psi. So psi of lambda must be the Legendre transform of S. So you can write psi of lambda as the minimum over f of minus S of f minus lambda f. okay? Because essentially the so the if you substitute here the expression that we found for S of F, then what you end up with is that the expression for psi of lambda is minus, is given by minus the log of Z of lambda, okay? So psi of lambda is given by this expression because, say, if you go back to this equation here, where we have written the solution, the maximum of the entropy as a function of lambda, then if you consider now lambda as a function of f, then this is just minus lambda times f plus log of lambda. So when you put this equation here inside this equation here, then you find that your function psi of lambda is equal to minus the log of c. So indeed, if you want to solve this problem, then the first thing is to compute the function psi of lambda. The recipe is to compute the function psi of lambda, which is minus the log of the partition function, and then to do the usual steps of the Legendre transform, which is to compute f as a function of lambda, which is the derivative of psi as a function of lambda. So actually with a minus sign, and then you can use this relation to compute the function S of F. And what you get also is that so you should invert this relation and find lambda as a function of f. And if you do that, you will find that this is also given by the derivative of s with respect to f with a minus sign. And so these two problems are related by the Legendre transform, and so indeed, say, they are exactly the same problem, and indeed psi plus s is equal to minus, when you compute lambda and f at their value, this is equal to lambda times f. So it's completely symmetric. So this function psi is called this function psi here is called a free energy. Or is closely related to what is called a free energy. Okay, as we will see when we discuss statistical mechanics. So very good. So of course this argument can generalize to any number of functions. So we may imagine that now, if we know if f is a vector of random functions, of say k random function, where fi of k of x is is a function of which we know the we know that the expected value of these functions is equal to some fi, then you can perform the derivation above, and you find that again you will have a distribution which is which has this exponential form, where now you should consider lambda as a vector of parameters, and each of these lambda is fixed by the condition that the derivative with respect to lambda I of the log of the partition function should be equal to the expected value of fi of x. Okay, and again you can show that this is a convex optimization problem, so the solution is unique, and so and also of course this notation should be interpreted as a scalar product, so this is sum from 1 to k of lambda I fi x, and so but it's essentially the same exactly the same same problem that we have seen before. Now so there are several ways to see that this is the correct solution. So for example, one way in which you can get this information here is if you get for example a sample. Imagine that you get a sample of IID draws independent values that are measured with, say, n independent experiments. And then, I mean, in these n independent experiments, you can measure, say, the average value of the function f. Okay. Okay. Then we know if we expect the law of large numbers to occur, that this should be essentially equal to the expected value of f. Okay. So if this is the value f that we measure, then we know that this should be equal to the expected value of f. Now, in a finite sample, you can write this as the sum over x of the empirical distribution times f of x. Okay, so this is your now if you ask yourself what type of empirical distribution will I see, then you can argue that the number of samples such that your empirical distribution is equal to a certain p, such that also and also that the expected value over this p of f is equal to f, then this number of samples will be given exactly by the multinomial coefficient, so it's just n factorial divided by product over I of product over x in key of n times px of x factorial, because this number here is the number of points in your samples that are equal to small x. Now, if you use Stirling approximation, you can see that this is asymptotically equal to e to the n times the entropy of p. So what you see is that the number of samples that have a maximal value of the entropy are essentially overwhelmingly more numerous than other samples that satisfy this condition, but that do not have this form here, that are not maximum entropy distributions. Okay, so we observe. So when we do these experiments, when we get this information from very large samples, from a very, very large sample, then the most likely distribution from which it comes from must have this maximum entropy form, okay? And also, from the point of view of statistics, so it's also interesting to notice that if you have a sample, if your sample X comes from a distribution which is this P of lambda and is IID, then the probability under this distribution of the sample is the product over all the I of the probability of lambda I. So it's e to the lambda times f of xi times divided by z of lambda. So it can be written as e to the lambda times sum over I from 1 to n of f of xi divided by z of lambda. So you see from this that the probability of a sample depend on the sample only through this particular combination here, which is the sum over I of the f of xi. So if you want to compute what is the correct value of lambda for a given sample, all you need to know of your sample is just this number, okay? It's just the number, so you can write this as e to the n times lambda times the average of f on the sample x divided by z lambda, this is to the n, okay? So you see that if you want to find what is the optimal parameter lambda star, which is essentially what maximizes the likelihood of a particular sample, okay? If you want to find the maximum likelihood estimator, then all you need to know is this particular combination of the variables in the sample, which is essentially the average of this function f of xi. Okay, so this is why this is essentially a mirror of the statement that these are distribution of maximal entropy, given that you fix the expected value of f. And it says you that if you want to estimate this probability distribution, all you need to know is the value of f, okay? Indeed, these objects that we are going to discuss again are called sufficient statistics. And they are called sufficient statistics because they are sufficient. It is enough to know the value of this combination of the of your sample in order to estimate your the parameters of your theory of your model. Okay, and all the rest, all the other information that is contained in this sample is completely irrelevant for knowing what is the model from which this random variable came from. Okay. Very good. So now I want to discuss two particular consequences of maximum entropy distributions, which relate to what we will see in statistical mechanics, and particularly in thermodynamics. And so imagine now that you have a system where you know that is formed of two random variables, x and x prime. And you can think of this as, say, for example, you have a system, and then there is a part, there are two different subsystems, and then you have, say, a random variable x defined on this one subsystem, and another part of x prime divided defined on the other subsystem. And then now imagine the situation where what you know is that the sum of these two random variables, the expected value of these is equal to some value f. Okay, then essentially given this information, if this is the only information that you know, then you can repeat the derivation that we did before, and the distribution, the probability distribution that decodes this information and only this information will be a probability distribution of the variable x and x prime, which is essentially exactly what I did before with lambda f of x plus lambda f of x prime divided by z of lambda. Okay, now what is this, which is a normalization constant? What is this? This is exactly of the form of p lambda of x times p lambda of x prime, where this p lambda is the distribution of is the distribution that we derived for a single variable x. Okay. So you see that so if this distribution is so if you know that a system as a whole has a certain value of the expected value of a certain function f, then its subsystem should have the same distribution. And also, this tells you that x and x prime are independent, okay? Or say, you if this is all you know, then you cannot say that x and x prime are independent, okay? Now, imagine that we want to when we solve this problem, we will have that the entropy of this probability distribution here expected value over this probability distribution of log of p lambda of x and x prime. Now, this of course I can write it as the maximum over f1 and f2 subject to f1 plus f2 equal to f of the entropies of the two separate problems. Okay, so imagine that I consider the two problems where the value of the variable x. So this problem here is a solution of the problem for the random variable x when I know that the expected value of f of x is equal to f1, and this is the entropy of the problem when I know that f of x prime is equal to f2. Then of course I should have that the entropy, so these are the maximum entropy distributions, and so the maximum entropy of the sum of the two must be given by this optimization problem. So then you see that the condition for this maximum is that here, of course, you can put F2, which is equal to F minus F1. So, and if you take a derivative here with respect to F1 of S1 of F1 plus S2 of F minus F1, then what you get is that the derivative of S1 divided by F1, and then here you get the derivative of S2 with respect to F2 when F2 is equal to F minus F1 must be equal to 0. Okay, so what you see is that the condition, so in these two systems, the one should have that the derivative of the entropy with respect to the expected value of f. Of the value of f of x in each of these systems must be equal, okay? And this is an equilibrium condition. So this tells you that if you want, this is the parameter lambda 1 of the first problem, this is parameter lambda 2 of the second problem. This condition tells you that if you have if all you know is an information about the total system, then the individual system are also described by maximum entropy distribution, where the conjugate parameters lambda 1 and lambda 2 must be equal. Okay. And you can generalize this to any number of subsystems, of course. And so this is a sort of an equilibrium condition. In the sense that what you know is that this parameter lambda for every subsystem should take taken separately for any subsystem should take the same value. Okay. Now the next and last observation I want to make is about what happens when you slightly modify the problem. So imagine that you have your original problem, which is given by the maximum of the entropy when you fix the expected value of F to be equal to F. Now you see that in this problem you have two type of variables. One are, say, what one could call internal variables. So these are, say, random variables which have a certain distribution, which that we don't see exactly. But this instead, the lowercase f are like external variables. So variables that we know and we measure, okay? So now imagine that I want to study how does this problem changes if the internal functions f of x change slightly. And also if the external variables, the measurement, also change slightly. And so these two changes, so the change in the uppercase F and the lowercase F, they don't need to be related. They can be arbitrary. They are not related in any sense. What I want to study is, say, how does the maximum entropy distribution of this problem and of these slightly modified problems are related to each other. In particular, what I want to compute is what is the change in the entropy of this problem here will be described by a certain P lambda, and is by a certain P lambda plus delta lambda. And I want to see how these two problems are related. Okay, so now there are of course say I have to see how does the entropy varies under these two perturbations, and the entropy at the maximum entropy is given by minus lambda times f plus the log of z. So the change of in the entropy would be given by minus delta delta lambda times f minus lambda times delta f plus the variation in the log of z. Now, log of z changes because of two factors. One is because delta f changes, the internal variables changes, and one is because the external variable changes, okay? So you can so the change in log of z is given by the delta lambda times the expected value of f, which is equal to f, lowercase f, plus lambda times the expected value of delta f. Okay, and well, the way in which you see this is simply because well, this is the first is the change in log of z if the delta f do not change, so to leading order you only have a change in delta lambda because you change the external variables, the lowercase f. And the other one is just the change induced by the fact that the internal variable changes, but the lambda does not change. Okay, so if you add these two terms, what you find is that this is delta lambda times f minus lambda delta f plus delta lambda times, now this is equal to f, plus lambda times the expected value of delta f. Okay, you see that the two terms that are proportional to delta lambda, that are proportional to delta lambda, not this one, to delta lambda, they cancel. And the change in the entropy is just given by two terms. One is minus lambda times delta f plus lambda times the expected value of delta f. So one can write this as lambda times a change delta q, where this delta q is equal to minus delta f plus the expected value of delta f. Okay, so this relation is a very general relation. So this is a sort of heat. And so this is a change in, say, internal in internal degrees of freedom of the problem. So this is what one could call in thermodynamics a change in the internal energy. And this is instead is the change on the external parameters that is usually associated to work. Okay, so as we will see then when we discuss the application of maximum entropy to statistical mechanics, so this this result here will correspond to the zeroth order, the zeroth law of thermodynamics that tells you that, say, intensive variables of a macroscopic system measured in different places on different subsystems should attain the same value. And the second one is the first law of thermodynamics that is essentially a statement of energy conservation that tells you that any change in the internal energy of a system must either be in the form of heat absorbed by the system or in work done on the system.